The traditional way of thinking about computation is that you have a computer, a Turing machine, and you have some problem, and that Turing machine has to solve that problem. But what we also often encounter is a slightly different situation, where suppose you have two computers and you have a problem, and those two computers want to solve this problem together in some way. Of course, to do this, they need to communicate with each other. And then the question is, how much do they need to communicate? How much data do they need to exchange to successfully solve this problem? Imagine, for example, if these two computers are on two different continents, then it might be quite important how much data they have to exchange. But this is not the only possible scenario. We could also have, say, two computers that are located in the same data center, and you want to solve some problem there, and you need to exchange some data between these two computers in the same data center. And even more than that, you could have a single computer, but that computer might have two processors, and so these two processors might need to talk to each other. And then you could have a single processor, and this single processor could have several cores, and these cores need to exchange some data to successfully work together to solve some problem, and so on. So we can really have communication on a wide variety of different scales. The area of computational complexity that studies problems like this is called communication complexity. And as it turns out, communication complexity is not only useful when you encounter settings that I described before, like these two computers in different data centers in the same data center, communication between two processors in the same computer, and so on. It also applies to settings where, at first sight, there is no communication going on at all. But it turns out that sometimes you have some type of situation you want to study that on the face of it doesn't involve communication, but you can reframe it in such a way that communication suddenly emerges, and you can then use the tools of communication complexity in those settings, which are rather surprising at times. And we will see one or two examples of that as well. In particular, this happens if the solution you're looking for relies on several pieces of separate data, and then you can imagine those separate pieces of data communicating with each other. And this can also be sometimes useful to show lower bounds. Lower bounds are, as you may have noticed, always a struggle in computational complexity. We have very few good lower bounds. We don't know, for example, for NP completeness, if those problems in that class really cannot be solved efficiently, because we don't have any good lower bounds. And in some situations, communication complexity tools can help us to prove lower bounds in certain settings for certain things.